until the first study of this was in 19 by an economist was in 1984, you know, 180 years after it happened. The first study comes along, and the guy, Journal of Economic History, found that about 50% of Massachusetts industry would have collapsed if it weren't for protective tariffs that were keeping out much cheaper British goods. And so there's another small market interference which isn't studied by economists, because we have a way of useful way of breaking the disciplines up to make sure that nothing is understood. Like if in the sciences, let's say, if you had one department that studied electrons, you know, and another department that studied mechanics, and a third one that studied light, and a fourth one that studied protons, and so on, and they didn't talk to each other, you could be sure you wouldn't know anything. And that's sort of the way it works. You can't do that in the sciences, because there you have to have progress. But outside the sciences, it's done all the time. So, for example, the economists may study things like protective tariffs, but they don't study things like, say, why cotton was cheap. Cotton was the fuel of the Industrial Revolution, like oil today. And it was kept cheap by a certain method that deviated somewhat from market principles, namely exterminate the population and bring in slaves. Pretty hard to think of a more sharp deviation from entrepreneurial values. But that's somebody else's department, so that's not called interference with the market. Plus lots of other things, like, you know, use of the British Navy to make sure that that Egypt doesn't undergo an industrial revolution, as it might well have. That's also not, you know, doesn't count. All right, so the United States comes along, huge protectionism. This continues right up until the present. In the late 19th century, the British, after 150 years of heavy protectionism, when they had already double the per capita capitalization of any other country, the British decided free trade might be a good idea. That's 1846, figuring they wipe everybody out since they dominated everything. That's the one time when free trade is considered a good idea, if you know you're going to win. Then people really are in favor of free trade. So the British moved to free trade in 1846, figuring they're going to win. For a while, Europe played the game, too, and played around with continental Europe. The United States never did, but continental Europe did play around with laissez-faire for a while. When they did, they sank into huge collapse, big recession, and they stopped, and they went back to pretty heavy tariffs, and then Germany and France and Italy and others started growing in the only way that anyone ever has, with plenty of state protection intervention. The United States never even played with it. U.S. tariffs were 5 or 10 times as high as European tariffs at that time. And in fact, that's the biggest growth period in U.S. history. And this goes right up to the present. I mean, as soon as the British said that they were, you know, you read history, they tell you the British had a period of free trade, which is partially true. They had lower tariffs. On the other hand, 40% of their exports went to the Third World, which means mostly the empire. And there's a reason why British goods went to India, which has nothing to do with free trade. But